Bowling may be one of the oldest sports in the history of the world. Over 100 million people in more than 90 countries practice the game, making it one of the most popular and universally loved forms of recreation on the planet. It has literally been the game of kings, and the startling facts behind the origins of bowling may even surprise the most dedicated kingpin. We are here at LA Bowl with manager Alan. We asked him a series of questions relating to bowling and his management of a bowling business. This is what he had to say.
Yeah, LA Bowl started in 1991 by a parent company called Quattro Ledger. Took over from Cricket Wiki, as it used to be known. They had three sites at the time, one on the Isle of Man, one at Leeds and one at LA Bowl Warrington. They ran with that for about 15 years or so. And then a couple of years ago, Leeds and the Isle of Man were sold on and the directors kept Warrington. Yeah, bowling's a very simple game. It's 10 frames and you get two goals to knock things down. Yeah, if you get a strike, you get 10 points plus you add on the next two goals, it gets more complicated as it goes on. Perfect game for 3 points. There hasn't really been anybody that's gone on professionally from this area. When we first started, there used to be what was the YVC, which is the Youth Bowling Club, which used to be on a Saturday morning where the guys used to come in and teach people how to bowl properly. People went on to win tournaments and become league bowlers. League bowlers, they go around and they bowl in a league at this site, say, every week in a tournament, in a round robin tournament. But there's no one gone on to really become a professional from this centre. My main role as manager, obviously, to ensure that everybody that comes in has a good time, that they're safe when they come in, the staff are well trained, and that we look after both staff and customers the same.
Every game has rules, but you don't need to know all of them if you plan to bowl for fun. The basic rules are: ensure that you are wearing bowling shoes for your own safety and so that you do not damage the lanes. Don't be impatient, wait for your ball to return. It shouldn't take too long for it to come back up the rail. You can bowl up to a maximum of 2 times per frame. If you knock all of the pins down, you cannot take another go because the computer registers this as a strike, which is an X on the screen, in which case it will move to the next frame. Should you miss any pins on your first go, you will get another chance to knock the remaining pins down in your second. But once you have bowled twice in one frame, the system will push the remaining pins down and give you a new rack of pins. Use the appropriate size ball to accommodate yourself. Bowling balls come in many different sizes, however you should experiment with some and test which one has the right finger size and the right weight size to ensure you bowl at your best. Make sure you do not step over the black line at the start of the lane, because by stepping on the lane and bowling, it doesn't matter if you hit one pin or get a strike, the computer will register it as a foul. However, these are just the most basic rules. If you plan to bowl in a league or a tournament, make sure you follow these.
Use a bowling technique that suits you best. The most common ones are a grip, a spin, straight on bowling, or walking up and throwing a ball. These are the most common techniques which are used by professionals. If you do not know how to use these techniques, simply ask a team member and they will show you how to use it. By using this, you will make a good look of yourself and eventually be able to call yourself a professional. When you step up, ensure that nobody is bowling either side of you. All leagues and tournament bowlers do this so that they can concentrate and not be disturbed by anybody. When you concentrate and focus more, you will find that you bowl better. Use the arrows on the lane. As you walk up, you will notice 7 arrows which point towards the pins. It is important to use these, as it becomes easier for you to get the amount of pins that you need. For example, by throwing a ball towards the centre pin, you increase your chance of getting a strike. If you have a pin on the left, for example, located on the corner of the lane, it is best either to bowl straight on or bowl from an opposite direction. So if it's on the left, bowl diagonally from the right, and if it's on the right, bowl diagonally from the left. Handicap represents how well you bowl. When you bowl at a professional level, it is usually as low as 20, but if you don't bowl as well, it is usually as high as 120. If you look at everybody's handicap, you will find that they all vary.
Okay, well, I'm secretary stroke treasurer. I used to do simply the treasurer's job, and I've only just taken the secretary's job over. It's quite daunting at first, but it's all done on a computer, and once you get to know the programme itself, it's very, very easy. So all I do is the scores every week, I put them in the computer, and the computer does all the work for me. Tells me who's winning, who's losing, who's got high average, who's most improved, and I don't have to work any of it out.
Oh, so it's not actually as difficult as it looks to run it then?
No.
So how do the score sheets and boards work then?
Okay, everybody fills their sheets in each week. And as I've said, this computer programme, there's one for scores, one for the layout of the lanes, one for the teams, everybody's names, everybody's handicaps, so all the information is in the computer. I collect all the sheets in every week, put all the scores in, and it's all done for me. So all I need teams to do every week is put out down individual scores and then top them all up at the bottom. The team with the most points gets 2 points. If you both get the same amount, you just share it and get 1 point each. And then the scores go into the computer. It's all added up each week.
Sam and I were talking about it earlier on, and I said, well, as far as I knew, the origins of bowling started somewhere in America. But how and why, I don't know. But I have a funny feeling Simon knows.
Have you looked at it?
You are right. It is sort of like on the origins of in Central America. Have you ever watched the Flintstones before?
Yeah.
Well, they're not taking the mickey. It was actually invented by Stone Age people. And it does actually date that far back.
Excellent.
Seriously, so everything like was the main things that we know today, like everything the balls are made out of, either plastic or anything like that, yeah. They were actually made out of stone at the time. It's because obviously, you know, that's the only technology they had back then, so.
Good research.
Very good. Yeah, I never thought of that.
Each lane is usually between 5 and 6 metres long. However, when people bowl, it is not that common that they do not see the arrows allocated near the front of the lane. These 7 arrows, which are usually red or black, are used for targeting. This is the same concept as darts. Many bowlers either get strikes or spares after bowling twice in one frame. However, they sometimes find themselves with some of the most difficult spares to pick up. These include the baby split with company, which is the 2-7-8 or 3-9-10. The barmaid, which is where one pin is hidden behind another, as you can see here. The bedpost, which is the 7-10 split and can also be said to be the most difficult split to pick up. And the big four, which is the 4-6-7-10 split. Sometimes, when attempting the spare, the bowler will miss the pins, resulting in a blow. This is a missed spare. The spare which is most common is the clothesline. This is the 1-2-4-7 or 1-3-6-10. These include the kingpin, aka the number one pin at the front of the pins. There are many terms for splits. To find them and their definition, go to www.bowlersparadise.com/help/glossary.